Truth Frequency Radio.
Can you count, suckers? I say the future is ours. If you can count. Now look, we have here before.
Broadcasting straight to you from a large spaceship, currently anchored over Raleigh, North Carolina, eagerly awaiting the 2017 Flat Earth International Conference. But that's a ways off, so let's talk Flat Earth until then, shall we? Hello, everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Clues, which propose that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Check it out at enclosedworld.com or just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, then what have you been doing during my first 99 episodes? Ooh, first phone call coming in. You know what? Let's grab it right away. You're on live with Strange World right now. What are we talking about? Hey. Hey, 845 area code. Hey. Hey, turn down your radio.
Hey.
Who is this?
This is Mark Sargent calling from a spaceship located over Dallas, North Carolina.
Really? Dallas, North Carolina? This person sounds vaguely familiar.
This is Mark Sargent. Do you know him?
I know Robert Paulson. Am I supposed to know Mark Sargent?
No, this is Mark Sargent.
Oh, boy. So let me get this straight. You guys have actually orchestrated a conference call to call me on my 100th?
We want to congratulate you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, man. That's awesome. I hadn't even really gotten to that part yet.
Yeah, this is the man with the idea. This is Mark Sargent from in his spaceship over Charlottesville, Virginia.
Okay, so I'm guessing that one of the people on the call on this conference call, and I have never received a conference call before, not like this. One of them's Candy, right? Mm-hmm. One of them is Mark from New York. One of them, who was the last one that just spoke?
That was from North Carolina.
Oh, cool, man! Right on. That's awesome. Thank you guys so much. I hadn't even gotten to that part yet. Sorry, go ahead.
The most ironic part about this is we all met and become like best friends through your show. So that makes it even better,
Oh, that's awfully nice. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, Mark, I'm gonna holler at you real quick and I'm gonna bounce and let them talk to you.
Okay.
Just want to let you know, man. We're happy for you. 100th episode. You've been doing a great job. You've really sparked a lot of other things. I mean, Zulu One, he started his channel. Now Candy started her channel, and I'm going to start a channel, and I should have my first episode up by this coming Sunday.
Right on, man.
Flat Earth Report.
That gives me warm fuzzies all over. That's fantastic.
Anyways, have a good night, and Candy, Mark, y'all have at it.
All right, see you, man.
All right,
so who's left? I got Mark. Wait, who?
Well, the real Mark Sargent. Please stand up.
I'm Robert Paulson. Who orchestrated this conference call? Was this done on Mark's side?
The three of us.
Yeah, we kind of all did. But we called from Mark's phone number because we know you recognize that 845.
I was going to recognize the 845. I probably wouldn't have picked up anything else that quickly. I figured it's like, okay, Mark's trying to get in. He's trying to get in first shot on my 100th show. So can you believe it's been...
Gunner said he's not going to pick up that early.
Well, normally I wouldn't. Normally I wouldn't, but I didn't have that many announcements. I was just going to do a kind of a thank you. In fact, when I hang up, I'll probably do my formal thank you to everybody that's out there. Can you believe it? 100? Because this is a weekly show, and that means I've been doing this 100 weeks. I think I missed
that's
a couple.
2 years.
Yeah, 2 years worth of.
55 years.
Wow. I can't believe I've been listening to you that long.
I know.
I know, me too.
No, I'm Mark Sargent.
Oh boy, I know that voice. Wait, how are you guys pulling this off exactly? Are you actually doing like a Google Hangout and then calling me from there?
No. You're live right now on YouTube too.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Awesome.
You're live on our call.
No, seriously, am I?
I called Mark, and Mark called you.
Wow, technology! You gotta love it.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, thank you guys very much. Did you have any, you know, because I do actually have a show I had to do. Did you guys want any
particular... Like I do have a show to do, guys. I do have a gallery.
As much?
Yeah, and the people on our panel right now, they're all, you could say hello to them. We have Vincent P., Kathleen, been taking tests, Carl... the Morgow, Brian, and I'm sorry, but I don't know who the other guy is. James, is that your name?
All these guys are in your hangout right now?
Right.
Yeah.
Awesome.
We wanted to call you. Thank you.
Oh, that's so nice. And here I am down in the States visiting family because my birthday is coming up. My birthday was not, by the way, on the 4th. It was, I don't know why Skype screwed that up. It's not for another couple weeks, but it is in April. So, but it does change
we'll
things.
We'll just do it again.
Yeah, I know. So
we'll just do it again.
Thanks. Awesome. Technically, I'm not an Aries. If I was born on the 4th, I'd be an Aries. So if I'm the 24th, I'm a Taurus for those people that are into that. Yeah.
Somebody did call Mark Sargent.
For the peanut gallery, stop planting flowers in people's yards who aren't going to water them. Don't waste your time with those people that are not going to water them.
That's good. Where'd
nice.
You get that?
Just a random quote, and I thought it was very appropriate.
Awesome. That's really, really good. That sounds like a bus. Wes, is that you?
Yeah. I'm on my bus. Come on.
No, I don't care. I'm just, that's what it sounded like. It sounded like a bus.
I didn't want to miss the call, so it's like,
No. It's totally cool. Okay, so Mark, I've got a quote from you from the Peanut Gallery, which is, if scientists invented the legal system, eyewitness testimony would be inadmissible evidence. But what's stranger about that, do you know who said that?
No, I do not.
Take a guess.
Einstein?
Nope. NDT.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, but
I was actually going to say, Neil Armstrong.
That's not too far off. That's actually fairly good, fairly accurate for him because he's a big believer that that your eyes can be fooled, that eyewitness testimony doesn't count, that only the math counts, only the hard science. And, you know, like when you see things with your own eyes, you can be tricked. I'm going, yeah, with certain things, sure, because our visual spectrum can be screwed up. But when it comes to what we're talking about, it's like, look, I don't care how many sets of eyes you have on it. All of them are going to be accurate when it comes to what the shape of the world is. You know, anyway. So, yeah, it was NDT.
That's crazy. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Go figure. Anywho, what's any shout outs you guys want to do? I'd love to stay with you. I really would, but I got emails I gotta read, I got phone calls I gotta take.
If you want to come jump in, I'm gonna fire up another hangout at midnight. I'll send you the link.
Well, okay. Not, wait, midnight? What? Midnight? What time zone?
Oh, that would be like 9 for you, Eastern.
Oh, okay. So, well, with, yeah, when my show ends at 9 Eastern, maybe.
Yeah, that's why we schedule around Globusters, you, and Patricia. We schedule all our stuff around y'all.
All right. Don't bank on me. I will try, but I've got to build the show and I've got to upload it because I've got an early ferry. I'm catching back to Canada tomorrow. So I don't want to, and I can't at least join a video hangout at the same time. Oh, wait a minute. Peanut Gallery wants to get in one more shot here. His quote is, "Forgiveness is the fragrance that the violet sheds on the heel that has crushed it." What? That's from Mark Twain. "Forgiveness is the fragrance that the violet sheds on the heel that has crushed us. Crushed it." Wow. If you can get
I really
it
like
in
that.
Before you hang up with it. Yeah, I just did. I just got it in there. Okay. That'll have to work for now.
Getting real now.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I'll get
it. Hey, I got a shout out for Nathaniel in California. He hasn't his wife is sick, but he's still been paying attention.
Nice.
What was it?
All right,
cool. And I want to give a shout out to everybody that has been by my side through all of this. Y'all are all great.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, that's been a crazy weekend. I met a lot of people. Awesome, right? Candy, holy cow. Nobody slept. Everybody's been up. Everybody's been working together, talking about things, all different subjects, just having a good time, laughing.
Yeah. Can you imagine, by the way, if again, the hangouts, how much energy is in the hangouts? Can you imagine the energy that's going to be at that conference in North Carolina this fall? Nobody is going to sleep. I actually half suspect that some people will stream from the lobby of the hotel pretty much nonstop until the next morning stuff shows up.
It's going to be like every time I hear that song, the Aeroplaster remade from Adele, I cry. It makes me cry like hysterically every time I hear it. So like song. I can't even imagine meeting all these people like.
Yeah, and she's gonna be there singing that.
Yeah, she told me that. Like that's crazy.
Yeah, that's gonna be awesome.
You know, it's just like.
Yes, Wes.
It's just like that old. It's like that saying, "Don't lose sleep over it." Well, every one of us are losing sleep over it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah, I cannot wait. The conference is going to be monumental, and the energy levels are going to be off the charts. So, and can't wait to see everybody there. And I know I'm not going to sleep very much.
I know. I'm not going to get any sleep at all.
All right. Any last shout outs before I move on to the next callers?
Shout out to Mark Sargent.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations.
Happy 100.
Congratulations.
Thank you. 100.
Congratulations on that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. 100 shows. Can't believe I did it. I'm going to use that joke.
Imagine
from
how many people you've reached in those 100 shows.
I try.
We'll discuss on whose idea this was after the show.
Nice. Okay. And wait, before I go, I'm going to leave you with this because it reminds me. There was one of my favorite comedians of all time. I saw him 3 times in concert was Stephen Wright. He was the guy that said, I bought powdered water, but I didn't know what to add, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, he made this great quote. He goes, "The Stones, can't believe they're doing it after all these years. Really great. I watch them whenever I can. Fred and Barney."
Awesome.
Anyway.
Thanks, Mark.
All right. Hey, you guys have fun, and I'm sure I'll be talking to you soon.
Bye.
All right, Mark.
All right. See you guys. Jeez, I'm getting all mushy. Everybody hang up so I can get rid of the background noise. Hey. Just like that. They were all gone. Here's a great way to open the show. A conference call. A bunch of people tied together. I don't know if they were actually piping it live through YouTube, but that's fantastic. I didn't even gotten through the info yet. I said, check out the clues on enclosedworld.com or just Google Flutter Clues. And if you hadn't figured it out, then you missed the first 99 shows that I did. Because this is episode 100. And for those of you listening to this on YouTube and want to hear the show live as it happens, if you missed it, missed the live part, please go to Truth Frequency Radio for the latest schedule. Currently, the show is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. If you are listening to it right now and it is not Tuesday night, you can call in, but it will go to voicemail and you will not be live. But if you want to talk to me live and it is Tuesday night, well, it's your lucky night. Phone number is 720-897-6111. That phone number again is 720-897-6111. You can call in right now, just like those people did. And yes, I know Peanut Gallery saying, don't forget the debate challenge. Yes, the Jeffrey Grubb challenge is still in effect. I'm going off of old notes here because I'm down in the States visiting family. So I don't have my up-to-date dialogue text. So I'm kind of winging it, which I think I could probably do after 100 shows. Jeffrey Grubb challenge. Anybody wants to challenge the flat earth from an academia standpoint, please, by all means, get a hold of me at msargent23comcast.net or call that phone number I just gave you and we will try to set you up. I mean, you can debate me if you want, but Jeffrey Grubb is dying to debate somebody, anybody. And the big money challenge is also in effect, and I don't have that email in front of me, but you can contact Zen Garcia at Secrets Revealed on this network, Truth Frequency Radio. And Peanut Gallery keeps shooting, don't forget, because it's the 100th show, you'll sing the Joe Jackson. I'm not singing Joe Jackson. I don't have the voice to sing Joe Jackson. I don't know many people that do. That's why Joe Jackson is who he is. That's why I let him do his thing. I like his song. Oh, there's a phone call. It's coming in. 613 area code. Let's pick him up. 613 area code. You are on live with Strange World. Who are you? What are we talking about? This better not be your first time.
Well, actually, it is, Mark. I can't hardly believe it. Dialed once and got right through. How about that?
Well, it's because you missed. Everybody else was in the conference call. I had four people on the line at the same time.
Actually, I was listening to that, and then I'm using the iPhone, so I flipped off that and dialed the number just as you gave it and said, you know, call. I figured to get in some kind of a queue or something, but here you are. I can't hardly believe it.
Well, it's because you don't get, and by the way, 586 area code. I'm on the call. I'll call right now. Just keep trying later. But yeah, there you go. Hang on. So, nothing gets filtered. So there's no producer picking it up and saying, okay, what do you want to talk to Mark about? Who are you? You're not crazy, are you?
You're the man every which way around then, I guess.
It's worked out really well because the topic that I cover, you don't get many trolls that are live. In fact, I have gotten, I think, maybe one or two total calls out of 100 shows that were trolls. You know, people actually, because if you're trolls, you don't want to give out your real number because, you know, caller ID is going to pick it up unless you block it. They also don't use real email addresses most of the time. No,
you know, I guess it's a character flaw on my part, but I tend to do things like you do. I give it my full name, the exact email address that it is, and, you know, let the chips fall where they may.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If you're talking about what you're passionate about and you believe in it, why wouldn't you give the real goods?
Good point. Now, when you said about right there, that's a northern accent.
I'm in Smith Falls, Ontario.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, that sounded vaguely Canadian.
Is that Lanark County twang or something coming through? I don't know.
No. Well, no, I'm not that. No, I don't have Canadian dialect down that well. In fact, I had to. I just learned recently because I've been collecting those license plates that there are 10 provinces and 3 territories. Right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. I'm trying to collect the what's the territory? And if you don't know, that's okay. Don't be embarrassed because you're Canadian and you don't know this. The license plate that's shaped like a bear.
Is it Northwest Territories?
That's it. Northwest Territory. There's Yukon, Northwest, and then there's a third one, and I can't remember the name of that one either.
Yeah, it'll come to me probably after the show.
It's not Nova Scotia, no. Prince Edward?
No, Nova Scotia is an actual province.
Hmm. Anyway, the point is, Canada's
I'm calling from Smith Falls, Ontario.
Yeah, what's going on?
My name is Barry Begley, and I was first turned on to this back in January of 2016, about a year after you were, I guess. Yeah. And I just spent I'm retired now. I just spent 3.5 months at that time looking into the Apollo situation.
Yeah.
And I thought that was the biggest thing that I fell into in the last, well, 9/11 or whatnot. But I thought the Apollo and the NASA thing was even bigger as far as the level of deception.
Yeah.
So I was finished with that in December of 2015. And so January 2016 rolls around. I thought, well, what am I going to take a look at now? And I kind of stumbled onto this flat earth thing, and I thought, no, I really don't. I mean, you know, if I do, well, we all know that we're on a spinning ball and it's hurling around space at 1,038 miles.
Of course.
And that's the whole thing that we've all been brought up with.
Yeah.
And I think the legitimate people that really have taken a strong look at this have started off, perhaps like I was, biased in favor of the globe model. And I was.
Yeah.
I'm basically looking at this in January of 2016 thinking, well, we'll take a look at it, see what happens. But this is going to take a whole day and I'll be done with it because I'm going to basically debunk the flat earth situation in favor of the globe. So admittedly, I'm rather ashamed to say from a scientific perspective that I was biased heavily in favor of the globe model.
Huh?
So, you know, that was a lot of turning around. And what did it for me, it took, a few weeks of, well, first of all, I'm thinking I'm just going to give it a day. This is going to take no time at all. So I'm in it for a day.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't find any proof, any solid proof of the globe model. I mean, you have to, at this point, of course, I discounted everything NASA does after coming out the 3.5 months of studying the Apollo and the NASA thing. So, you know, this has to be something where the rubber meets the road and is provable and duplicatable, et cetera.
Yeah.
I couldn't find anything in that day. So, the one day became 2 days. Well, a year and a half later, I haven't found one single piece of evidence that is in favor that proves the globe model. But I found, thanks to you and Eric Dubay and Dr. Robotham from 150 years ago, et cetera, literally close to 500 separate pieces of evidence proving the flat Earth model, the stationary flat Earth.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
The evidence is pretty well, you know.
Oh, I know, which is really why this show keeps going and why the community just keeps growing and growing.
Well, you know, Mark, my hat is off to you, sir, because, I mean, you have been a rock in this whole situation, and I'm sure you've caught a lot of fleck over the time that you've been involved with it, you know,
a couple of years ago.
And I guess that's kind of when you know you're doing the thing right, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, you have to do what you have to do.
Yeah.
I'll tell you how serious I was about this. I've actually written a book now that was published, and it was just published in March, actually. It's called, and I'm not trying to put a plug in here.
No, go ahead.
But I just, you know, the reason I mention it, I did send you an email. It would be, I think, about February or March of last year.
Okay.
And we had a kind of an email thing going back a couple lines, and I mentioned that and you actually read the letter out on air, which I appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, I was looking for a way of, I'm thinking, okay, if this lunar thing is, you never did it, you couldn't do it even today, et cetera.
Yep.
What about the distances? And I'm thinking, and I don't want to digress off the flat model, but this kind of all ties together.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking, is the distance to the moon really 240,000 miles? And is the sun 93 million? And is Polaris, North Star, 4 quadrillion, whatever that is? And I thought, well, probably the simplest place to start would be the moon situation because of spending several months looking into that whole thing. And I come up with a way of doing it. But that correspondence that we had literally involved at least 3 people on a triangulation thing. And it was, you know, it's going to be kind of difficult to coordinate and set up. Well, since that, in February of last year, I come up with a way. I thought, I have to do this so that it works in a model form initially. And I thought the simplest way, I'm not going to get into all the math right now, but that's why I mentioned the book, because I walk the
person. Just so you know, you got about 90 seconds till the break, so do what you can.
Okay, well, I am rattling on. So
that's okay, that's okay.
So anyway, I come up with another way of doing it where an individual person can do it from wherever they are with equipment that would, if they don't have it in their own home, would cost them no more than $10, literally. and the accuracy rate is really decent. The figures that I've come up with on three or four separate experiments over the course of about 3 months all tied in around the same figure, around 3,600 statute miles.
Hmm.
I did it the first night, and I ended up with like 3,750 miles. I was blown away. I went over the figures, went over the approach, and that's why I put the whole thing in the book. I've even literally taken a picture of my rough notes, and they are in the book as well.
Do this, because I don't want anything to be wasted. Can you give people your email address so that they can get a hold of you if they want to read it?
Definitely. The book is on Amazon.com. If you just put my name in, if you're on Amazon site, just go to Amazon.com. Just put my name, Barry Begley, and it'll take you right to the book. It's available in an email format or in a hardbound print version.
Spell your last name real quick.
Begley.
Perfect, because I wouldn't have gotten that.
And either. The email address, I'll give you that too. It's also in the book. Is BHBegley. It's BHBegley at gmail.com.
Awesome. Perfect. Any shout outs? Because once the music goes, we are going to break. Any
yep,
shout outs
yep.
you want to?
I can't hear it because I don't have the radio on. So just.
Although I'll let you know what anybody want to.
Oh, well, I wanted to congratulate you on your 100th show.
Well, thank you.
And I don't think the movement, quite frankly, would have been where it is today without your presence.
Wow, thank you.
And the videos are what can I say? They're awesome.
Well, thank you. And the music's going. So unfortunately,
okay.
you do too. But thank you very much for calling in during my 100th show. And we'll talk to you again soon, okay?
You're entirely welcome. Thanks, Mark. Congratulations.
Right. See you, man. Bye-bye. Bye.
We are TFR.
My faith in destiny is all I need to prevail.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 2 of 4. This is the 100th episode. Normally I'd insert some sound effect here, but we've got a caller on a line from 586 area code. Where are you from? Is this your first time? What are we talking about?
Yeah, Mark, this is my first time calling. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Right on. What's happening up
there
in Ann Arbor?
I want to congratulate you on your 100th show. I've been a long-time listener, man. Since
Thanks.
About somewhere in 2015, I started getting into the Flat Earth movement, and it consumes me. Every single night, I'm listening to YouTube videos. I listen to your show every Tuesday, and I think it's a great thing you're doing. You know, there's a couple other guys I listen to, and it's great.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Yeah, man, you are actually the first person that I've actually spoken to who believes in the Flat Earth movement. My friends think I'm just off the wall. They don't want anything to do with it. You know, they're so indoctrinated. They just won't listen to what I have to say.
That will happen, but at the same time, I believe that you already know people that are into Flat Earth, but you just don't know how to broach the subject. You know, I mean, it's not like it's so different from Fight Club in that regards, where with Fight Club, you just look for guys with bruises and black eyes and cuts and stuff like that. But Flat Earth, you have no idea if the person next to you is in it. And I know that there's people out there. In fact, you probably heard some calls recently where it's like, oh, yeah, you're into that. I'm into that. But unless you get it is that weird, awkward moment where neither side wants to bring it up. Look at the groups that are forming. Oh, in fact, I got to do that trailer for, there's a group happening in Colorado weekly now. There's that group now happening in Florida. The national conference is coming up, which I still haven't really plugged yet. So, but yeah, I'm glad that I can help and be part of your journey, because it's a journey.
Yeah, and you're so.
Go ahead.
You're so right about that. Sorry, I keep cutting you off.
No.
You're
go
so
ahead.
Right about that. Like, I work with a guy. I'm a painter, and he's into conspiracy theories, and he's, you know, always giving me DVDs to watch and stuff like that. And I keep asking him, what do you think about the flat Earth? What do you think about the flat Earth? And he shoots it down every single time.
Sure.
I'm like, the things that he's into and believes, it's like, really? And you won't even look at this?
Yeah, that's why in literally the first 60 seconds of my video, the first clue, the introduction to the clues, the first thing I said was, look, there, I know people in the conspiracy world who absolutely believe that everybody in the high ranks of government are lizards, that they're part of a reptilian race. And yet, literally they believe that. And again, I come at them and I say, oh, hey, what if you check this flat earth thing? And it's just like, whatever. You're nuts if you think that. It's like, really? Really?
At the same
time, you know, I can't come down on anybody now. I will say this. Once I got into flat earth, I literally can't make fun of anybody in the in any other doctrine. How
could you? Yeah, since we, like you say, you know, since you're a little kid, first grade, there's a globe in the corner, and you know, why do you stick to the globe? Gravity, you know, and it's like, and it never really made sense to me as a kid. You know, it never did. I could never grasp that. I could regurgitate the information I was taught and you know, get it right on a test, but it just still, in my heart of hearts, I knew it wasn't right.
But you're a kid, you're not smart enough. And you know that there's adults that are older than you that you believe in the authority, because when you're a child, which is why I use the Santa Claus reference so many times, when you're a child, you don't believe that people in authority would lie to you. And even if you believe, it's like, okay, maybe my parents might lie, but not my politicians, not the people in science, not my teachers. And again, it's not that they're deliberately lying to you. It's not that anybody's in on this. It's just that they're preaching the word that was told to them, and it's just passed down from century to century. So anyway,
I appreciate you taking my call, man. And there's one thing I wanted to ask. I was wondering if I could, I was wondering if I could give out my email address. And
yeah.
Maybe if anybody in the surrounding area, you know, could shoot me an email.
Out in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Go ahead. Shoot. What do you got?
Yep.
And don't forget to leave your name too.
Sure. Well, my name is Charlie Van, and my email address is charlievanpainting@gmail.com.
Is that Van as in V-A-N, like Van down by the river?
Yep.
Van?
Yep. Okay.
charlievanpainting@gmail.com. So if anybody's up in Michigan and you're wanting to put a hangout together and you have just said, there's nobody in Michigan. No, there's plenty of people in Michigan. And Charlie's one of them.
Cool, man.
All right.
Yep, thanks for taking my call.
Hey, have a good one. See ya.
You too. Bye.
We're going wall-to-wall calls, and I just picked up somebody. Who did I pick up? Is that 908 area code? I can't tell. 908, are you there?
Yes, I'm here, Mark. What's up, Mark? Congratulations on the 100th show.
Thank you. Where, 908, where are you calling from? Because I don't have...
Jersey. You're from Jersey. Jimmy,
Jersey.
From Jersey.
All right.
What's today's my birthday, man.
It is?
Yeah, for real. Just turned 28.
11th.
Over a year.
That makes you an Aries, like my sister.
Yeah.
Nice. Aries.
I just have one question for you, Bart.
Yeah.
What happened between you and Daphne?
Yeah. You know what? I will answer this. And we're talking about Daphne Rimmel, R-I-M-M-E-L, from the YouTube channel of the same name. Nothing really happened. She just decided, I mean, she and I were perfectly cordial all the way up until the point where she decided she was going to take her own path. That was it. And, you know, she thought that, you know, she liked some of my stuff, but she didn't think that I was edgy enough. She didn't really enjoy the fact that I didn't like to swear on air and use profanity, which is fine. I mean, it's one of the things I chose to do. so and her approach is a little more in your face, more abrasive, you know, try to you kind of a Jersey way in but you know, even though she's not, in fact, it's not surprise me if you like Daphne. I mean, Daphne's not necessarily an acquired taste, but you got to be ready because she'll smack you in the face. But that was it. I don't think we ended necessarily on bad terms. She decided to take her own road, and I wish her the best in whatever she decides, however she wants to go down this. And I've got no malice towards her whatsoever. I mean, I backed her channel. I interviewed her, and I still think she could benefit this movement in the community in a big way if she so chose. So there you go.
All right.
Anything else?
Are you on tomorrow with Patricia?
I am on tomorrow. Thank you for reminding me, because otherwise I probably would have forgotten the program. Well, because the 100th
right.
show.
Can you do me a favor?
What?
Can you tell her to give me a birthday shout out too?
Oh, yeah. Patricia should so give a birthday shout out too. I'm sorry. Your name was again?
Jimmy Shu.
Jimmy. Oh, wait a minute. Do I know that one? Have I gotten emails?
Yeah, I emailed you a couple times.
Yeah. Jimmy Shu. Got it.
From Jersey.
Jimmy Shu from Jersey. Okay. Hopefully, Patricia will write this down, and we'll give you a birthday shout-out tomorrow.
All right, Mark. Have a good night.
All right, you too.
Hey,
bye-bye. While I'm waiting for the next call, I also got a physical mail because some people have already figured out that I have added at least for the States, because I'm not having stuff. You don't have to mail stuff up to Canada where I am when I spend time in Victoria, but you can mail things to the States, and that address is in the description box of literally every single video that's there, and I will get the package eventually. So if you guys want – so somebody sent me something. His name is J.J. Dawes, I believe, D-A-W-E-S. Hopefully that's right. He goes, hey, Marks, you said cookies, so I sent them, and he sent me a USB drive containing some of my music. You're free to use if you need them. Peace, J.J. Dawes. Reverb – it's also – he's under Reverb Nation under J.J. Dawes. I should say that name a few more times. And he literally set that to me on a 3x5 card. So thank you for that. And the cookies were delicious. And 314 area code. 314, you are on live with Strange World right now.
Hey, Mark. It's Corey from St. Louis. I called a few weeks ago, about a month ago now.
Hey.
I just wanted to call, and I just one or two questions for you. I noticed you had to re-upload your third interview with Rob.
And the first interview with Rob.
I re-listened to him because, I mean, why the hell not? And I was just curious why you had to re-upload him. Did they get struck, or was it?
No. Just so people know what happens with YouTube, YouTube has level of striking systems. Now, they can, you know, if you use a piece of copyrighted material, they can say, well, you can't monetize it. That's the first level. The second level is where the person says, no, we have the exclusive rights to it, so we're just going to block your video worldwide or mute it worldwide or something to that effect. And the third stage, if they really don't like you for whatever reason, and it's rare, it does not happen that often, and that is they can actually formally say, well, you need to pull down everything about this video. It offends us. And that's called a copyright strike. And then you can appeal it, of course. When it came to the Rob Skiba videos, what I had done, that was back when I was using some cool little snippets like cartoon beginnings. And with Rob's videos, I believe that's when I was using a lot of space stuff. So I used the intro to Space 1999, the television show from the 1970s. And you're saying, well, why didn't, you know, that was 18 months ago. Why in the world would they copyright, you know, why would they block it? And sometimes rules change over the years. So like at the beginning of this year, Fleetwood Mac changed its copyright things on YouTube, and Joe Jackson and other people. And so videos that can be up there for a long time, years, in fact, all of a sudden you can't watch them anymore because they're being blocked. And that's what happened with Rob. So some of the people that keep track of my videos, some listeners, they said, hey, you know, Rob's video is now blocked in all countries. It's like, ah, crap. So luckily I keep all the originals, and I just put it to a new slideshow, and you know, I just replaced the audio and put it up there.
Cool beans.
Yeah, that's why.
Oh, awesome. Well, yeah, it was funny because I thought you were, like, trying to re-upload him and be like, hey, I'm going to have him on soon. That's what, you know, something
no,
like that.
No. Nothing.
You two get together, you guys bounce off each other really, really well. So well,
thank you. That's why he's interviewed me 3 times, and I've been on several panels with him. And there's some people that I really enjoy bouncing around stuff with. You know, like Patricia and David, I'm sorry, DITRH and Jaron and Bob. There's a whole bunch of people that I really like, but Rob's great. I love Rob.
Yeah. He just had someone on his show. I can't even remember right now. I think it was DOT, or whatever his name is. Oh shoot. It's losing me.
Wasn't ODD. Was it?
Yeah, it was. Yes, it was. Yeah.
Bob Skiba had ODD on. Did I miss that?
Yeah. He had him on. 2 weeks ago. He's been really consistent with his show lately, so awesome. I would think the three of you getting together and talking at one point would be awesome for all of us.
Well, you know that all of us are going to be there at the conference. So,
right. But
yeah,
those of us that can't, maybe like a precursor before the conference and stuff like that.
That's a good idea.
I like the way all three of you approach it. He's got the Bible side, you've got a mixture of pretty much everything.
Yeah.
And ODT's got a ton of stuff too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's awesome. And really appreciate everything you're doing.
Thank you.
I'll let you go. I know you got calls. Every night.
100th show, yeah. When I lead with a conference call, you know it's going to be bad.
So. Oh, I totally forgot it was the 100th show. That's awesome. I'm on the 100th show. That's great. I'll watch you tomorrow and hopefully I can get in the chat. Look for Flat Earth STL is my channel. I'm trying to put it together for you guys.
Will do.
So, talk to you later, Mark. Have a good day.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
See ya. All right. We still got, 10 minutes? Jesus. 10 minutes to the second break, and will I actually get to my first email? Let me look at the peanut gallery, and... Holy smokes, I'm actually going to make it my first email. I know there were some calls that came in, but since there's a little bit of a time delay, they'll probably call back. Let's see if I can get through one. This one's called, Please Read Quick Message About the Space Shuttle. This is confusing to me. A 747-100 model that was released in 1969 is strong enough to fly the last space shuttle that flew in space? Please see the attached picture that's making question if it's even a real space shuttle on top of the 747-100 also... 747 is the first series. The engines on the 100 is nowhere near as powerful as the 747/400, currently the modern version. NASA is telling me that a plane older than the space shuttle can carry basically another plane almost the size of a 747 on top of it. Could be just a model to look like the space shuttle. Also, if you noticed it in the picture how rusted the space shuttle looked and how worn out it is by the time they ended the space shuttle flights, I'm amazed people were even willing to go on it. They would have to hold me at gunpoint for me to fly in the space shuttle, considering how worn out it looks. And yeah, I remember that. In fact, I used to have a toy. It was a big thing back then because I made a trip down to the Kennedy Space Center when I was 13, I believe, down in Florida. And that was one of those toys I bought. You could actually buy a 747, cool little, in fact, you could probably look this up on eBay, little die-cast toy. It wasn't even plastic. With a space shuttle that sat on top of it, and not very well, I might add. It didn't like click in, so it would like fall off really, really easily. But it was interesting because, yeah, you could see that's how it was transported from one place to another. It flew on the back of a 747. So yeah, interesting. Well, you know, did they use that to, you know, considering what it could do? Could you just not take a 747 to max altitude and then disconnect the space shuttle? Sort of like they did with in one of the Superman movies. Remember, I'm a big comic book guy. The Superman Returns with Brandon Roth, R-O-U-T-H. I really like that one. I mean, other people like other ones better, but I really like that one. Peanut Gallery says, the Enterprise, they flew the thing every time they landed in Texas to take it back to Florida. Huh, there you go. See, the Peanut Gallery is good for stuff. This email is called No Subject. You guys got to put a subject line in there. Mark, it's Steve from New York City. Hey, Mark, great job you're doing and keep up the good work. I was reflecting on how satellites are not falling from the sky anymore as they used to a couple of days, decades ago. Of course, the answer here is that they don't fall from a place called space, etc. So it got me thinking about how rocket stages have been located visually through the Google Earth image software. So at some point, will it be the case that the DoD will blank out with dedicated software the very images of future rocket stages fallen to Earth? Which also makes me think that I have never seen a launch as reckoned from any satellite ever. NASA says it has more than 42,000 satellites logged into its system, and still none of any of NASA's trillion-dollar equipment have ever rendered a continuous moving image of any launch. Taxpayers are certainly asleep at the switch. Also, how will Mr. Musk from SpaceX be able to do the impossible and orbit his space passengers around the moon? I was starting to like go into a Bill Shatner thing there. Do you suppose he will utilize his new corporate brain research company to hypnotize these subjects? And later he could claim that hypnosis is an integral part of space travel to slow down metabolic function and to relieve the monotony of the journey. He would then have his subjects proclaimed heroes with Nobel Prize and all, and pocket the money from the staged mission. What do you think of this moon fantasy thing? Steve in New York City. Oh, yeah. I know Steve, and he didn't listen to my rant that I went off. A couple things. I did a separate video on the whole SpaceX program, how they're thinking about. In fact, I think I called it SpaceX is not taking tourists to the moon. I think that's what my title was. And is No. SpaceX even talking about taking people around the moon by next year is so unbelievably reckless and ridiculous. It's amazing that more scientific journals haven't launched a campaign against SpaceX saying, what are you guys doing? And Peanut Gallery is chiming in saying, oh, there's a picture of the... In fact, you know what? I think I used a 747 with a space shuttle on top as one of my thumbnails. A collision between a 1 centimeter fragment and a satellite at orbital velocities can be compared to an exploding grenade, according to Holger Krag, head of the European Space Agency's Space Debris Office. There are over 18,000 objects in orbit around Earth that are being tracked by ground stations. And that's information is straight from space.com. Super great. This email, we're going to see if we can do a couple more. If anyone, I'm sorry, the phone number, 720-897-6111. That's 720-897-6111. Let's see here. This one's called Beauty Day. It just feels better knowing how the sun and the moon really work. I understand that the God of creation is worthy of excellence in engineering. I am humbled in awe of the simplicity of design and blown away by the complexity at the same time. I bought my early bird ticket. He's talking about the conference. Hope to see you at the rally. Oh, nice. So he spells the city rally followed by R-A-L-L-Y because there's going to be quite a few people with flat earth license plates going down there. And I think he's going to be driving down from Ontario. So that's awesome. He's got his on a little Subaru, souped up Subaru something. But that's really awesome. That's great. This one's called... we're going to take a phone call from 269 area code. 269 area code, you are on Live with Strange World right now, and you got about 5 minutes until we go to break. So what's going on?
Oh, geez, I don't need that much, Mark. It's Reverend Shane.
Well, for you, Reverend, you can have all the time you want.
Well, I wanted to say is we finally got a hold of one of these. The package says is a non-contact thermometer.
Okay.
And yeah, and it's the fancy futuristic ones that people have been using, where you just point and click, and it tells you what the temperature is, and the thing is amazing.
Yeah.
It's and according to what they tell us, it is, quote, spooky science, unquote. because obviously none of us can see infrared.
Yep.
And but it seems to be working fine, and it's just a generic one. It's by Myres brand. If anybody is up north, they might be familiar with Myres stores, Myres, markets.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like it's fine. And So I got it for my homebrew kit stuff, right?
Okay.
Yeah, because I'm interested in brewing wine and trying different things with herbatology, whatever you want to call it, the study of plants.
Okay.
Right?
Yep.
Yeah. And
herbalism, I think.
Thank you. Yes, herbalism. Yes. And so, I'm interested in trying these things and brewing wine with them, and the premise was, of course, to keep the yeast happy. You got to measure the temperature.
Sure.
Yeah. So it not only did I want it for that, but then also, of course, I'm going to try your moonlight experiment.
Yep.
So I just wanted to call, give a shout out to you for the 100th.
Thank you.
I got my tool. Yeah.
Right, and I hope the experiment goes well. Try to do it when it's better time of the year right now, because you want the moon to be kind of like the sun, be as high in the sky as possible. And just try to make it as scientific as you can. If you want to go all out, 800 number is calling me. I'll pick that one up later. We got to go to break here in a sec. You go check out the wonderful test that was done at zeteticism.com, the website, or I'm sorry, the YouTube page, where he actually put copper strips in water and was temperature gunning the water, and he was brilliant test. You would really enjoy it.
So he measured by the copper itself. Is that what he?
Yeah, he was pointing at the copper in water. And then he did three. He did one that was not in moonlight, one that was in moonlight, and then one that was magnified moonlight. So he took like a jeweler's arm, or one of those magnifying glasses that's on a pedestal thing, and he pointed it to where he was magnifying the moonlight, and sure enough, it was getting colder. So the moonlight was colder, and then the magnifying moonlight was even colder than that.
Okay, well, we will hold a giant magnifying glass in our hands if we have to. I have one.
Nice. Well, yeah. I mean, you can get a jeweler's arm or a rocker arm, something that can hold it in place. Don't sit there and try to do it. Because remember, it's going to take a while.
Okay. So. All right. Well, we got time's on our side.
That's true. So you got about 40 seconds till we go to commercial. Any shout-outs you want to give?
Oh, geez. Shout out to you, of course, Mark. And shout out to Candy. I heard her on earlier.
Cool.
And Mark from New York. How about
that? Right on. That's awesome. All right, man. Well, thank you for calling in during the 100th show. It's awfully nice to hear from you. And
no problem at all, dude. I'm happy to try to confirm your experiment.
All right. Well, let me know how it goes. And if you take any video of it, I'll show it on my channel.
Awesome.
All right. Hey, have a good night. Okay.
All right. You too. Have a good one now.
All right.
Come on.
See ya. And okay, we're going to be coming back to the second hour. Part 3 of 4. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111.
Tuned into the truth frequency.
We are TFR. TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Major Kong. I'm ready to target the ICBM.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 3 of 4. It's the 100th episode. Go figure. And this is a weekly show, so minimum 100 weeks, 2 years, flat earth, every single show. With the exception of the stint I did at the very beginning where I did a couple of my favorite end of the world movies, my fireworks story, and a couple others. But for the most part, I have stayed on track, stayed the course. Flat earth. I do not deviate. Other people, you guys want to go into separate things, that's fine. I am not going to. I am in this till the inevitable conclusion, whatever that may be. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. 720-897-6111. Operators are standing by, and by that I mean me. So when you do call, don't be mean, because remember, no matter where you go, there you are. Flat Earth news. And not the Wes Stacy kind. It's just where I go into YouTube. I type Flat Earth. I set the filter to 1 week. And I still get just a wall of results. And try to see if there's anything that catches my eye. Let's see. Lots of new people. Live, in fact, Zulu 1. Wait, why is Zulu 1 running a hangout right now? You're supposed to be listening to my... Am I being broadcast on that show right now? I'm not going to click on to find out. But that's Mark from New York. You guys probably figured that. He was the guy that did the conference call at the beginning of this show. And he often does it now with Candy Franklin. She's new to the game, and she's doing all sorts of stuff. She's fun to listen to. Jazz Sinclair, he's back in it, making some more videos. There's so many new people. In fact, I'm rechecking my filter just to make sure I set it to 1 week. That's how I know this thing's getting huge. Well, that and other metrics, which are going through the frickin' roof. Paul Michael Bales is back in it. Political Hillbilly. He's doing hangouts. I'm just going to page 3, see if anybody catches my eye here. So many things. Black Hole Interactive. And, of course, you know, I can't forget that I'm a member. You guys, and I'll remind you at the end of the show. Hopefully I will. Maybe the Peanut Gallery will remind me that tomorrow I'm going to be on Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. I believe that is episode 155. I mean, yeah, I've done 100 shows, but Patricia's done 155 shows. Now, granted, she's not restricted to a weekly show, but it's amazing. You know, talk about focus. And yet they still come at her, and she keeps knocking them down, which is great. With grace. I might add, she doesn't swing a baseball bat. She kind of swings a gold scepter that isn't even really that heavy, in my opinion. And you know what's also amazing is that as I'm looking through this, there's hangouts. Here, you want to know how this thing is, why this thing is getting huge or an indicator, is that there's so many. Maybe you'd be lucky two or three times a week you may get a Flat Earth hangout. And now we have hangouts, Flat Earth hangouts that are stepping on each other's toes right now. So even though Zulu 1's got a hangout going, so is Turquoise Dragon, Flat Earth Maps, Geometry, Vortex, Math, and Circles. He's running it right now as well, simultaneous. That's happening all the time. There's always a Flat Earth hangout going on. You want to get into the Flat Earth? Hey, join one of these chats, start making comments, and get on if you got something to say. You don't have to be nervous. Look, it's just average, everyday people. I'm a little strange, but I wouldn't consider myself necessarily exceptional. Other people might. I don't. Anyway, enough of Flat Earth news. And what else should I plug real fast? Let's plug the enclosedworld.com. If you guys want to check out some stuff, that's just my main webpage. Or just go to YouTube and type in Flat Earth Clues. Eventually you get to my main website, Mark K. Sargent. Flat Earth Clues, book of the same name, audiobook, same, the apps, everything else. Yeah. Let's get back to emails, shall we? Since the phone calls have gone quiet for just a few minutes. Maybe I can actually get through. Last week, it was almost a damn near record. I made it through 2 emails. And today, I think I'm going to top that. But that's probably because a lot of people piled into the beginning of the show. This one's called Eötvös Effect, and I'm going to have to spell this for you guys. Eötvös, and the O's have double dots on the top, and I don't know what that does to the pronunciation. says, hey, Mark, great show with not so hostile phone calls. There, he's talking about when I was on Parabnormal Radio with DITRH, and we were supposed to take hostile phone calls. They couldn't find a scientist to go up against us, so they opened up the phone lines. No one went up against us. That shows you something. Because I would, we did that show last year, and if they would have opened it up to calls, they would have just lit us up. Not now. I think the balance of power has started to shift in our favor. Anyway, about the, we'll call it Otovos effect, it seems very interesting. Basically, they're saying the Earth's spin causes centrifugal force, and that going with the spin west to east increases the force, and going against the spin east to west decreases the force, and that this change is measurable, 3 or 4 grams difference in a weight of 10 kilogram mass. To that, I would say if the Earth's spin does have an effect on weights of objects, then certainly there must be a weight change for a stationary object at a high latitude that should get lighter due to more centrifugal force from the Earth's spin when the same object is placed at the equator. However, I don't know if any test that shows this. These would be excellent experiments for flat Earth researchers, perhaps a gemologist. Is that a word, gemologist? Who has access to fine-tuned electronic scales and can measure a 50-gram object in higher and lower latitudes and see if there's a weight change. See the wiki entry here under EOTVOS effect. And yeah, this was something that I brought up in the very first interviews, and I haven't talked about it recently because I figured everyone had already heard it by now. But let's review, shall we? And that is, if the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, like a merry-go-round, that means that things at the equator should be counteracting gravity more than things at the North Pole. Remember, the North Pole, you're spinning at 0 miles an hour, but at the equator, supposedly spinning at 1,000 miles an hour. So if you have a 10, we'll use pound because I'm in America, American, 10-pound object at the North Pole, it weighs 10 pounds. If you move that same object down to the equator, shouldn't it weigh a little bit less? Just a little bit? Measurable? You know, we have electronic scales now. We should be able to figure this out. And yet I have never heard of it weighing less. So we'll check it out. Peanut Gallery says, shouldn't centrifugal force throw you off the surface? No, I don't think it should throw you off the surface, but I think it should clump up water. I think there should be no different than Saturn's rings. Well, a little different because it's not going to be flying out in space. I think there should be a bulge of water around the center of the equator if you believe in the globe. So, shouldn't play centerfold. Oh, yeah. Jay Giles, the guy, the lead singer for Jay Giles, he died today. And everyone, people have been sending me links. It's like, yeah, I didn't realize he was that old, though. I didn't realize that when he was really making a lot of his hits, he was already into his 40s. So, I will list all your SME you've done on Flat Earth News. SME? You haven't listed in a long time. Oh, subject matter experts. Dude, don't say SMA. SME. That's not a TLA. All right? SME isn't a thing. But yeah, you're right. Subject matter experts. Subject matter experts. Let me read them off real fast. Anyone wants to chime in? And I haven't done one in a little while. It's because we've covered them all. United States Navy missile instructor, Air Force navigator, United States Marine Corps sniper instructor, Navy submarine chief, an Army artillery radar operator, Australian intelligence officer, an American flight instructor, an industrial engineer specializing in valves and seals, a career surveyor of 32 years, an international shipping expert, a corporate travel agent, air traffic controller, United States Army master gunner, aviation and ground training combat expert, USDA surveyor of 27 years, 32nd degree Mason, etheric science researcher, commercial airline captain, and a merchant marine. More to come, I'm sure. But if anybody wants to either go against these guys who have said that, yeah, it seems like the Earth is flat and that there is no Coriolis effect and that the maps are wrong, all these people are saying that, or you can chime in with them. I don't mind. I'd love to talk to another Air Force guy or another Navy guy. Don't mind at all. I mean, yeah, we got a pretty good list and they're all under the Testimony Shows playlist on my YouTube channel. But I wouldn't mind talking to some more. Why not? So you can do it anonymously if you want. You don't have to use your real name. You definitely don't have to do it on video because it's a radio show. And then we can, you know, or we can do a pre-record, or I can read a statement for you if you're that nervous. I've done that before too. like the Marine sniper instructor that taught for 3 years. I read a statement by him. He didn't want to come on because I think he was still in. I think he was still in the Marines. All right, let's do an email real quick. This one's called It Is Flat. Mark, I am in the internet business. In 2001, I started a wireless internet service. We could connect with line of sight within a 15-mile radius. When we did the math to connect to clients, we figured in the drop of the earth. First time I've ever heard it called a drop. Through time, I hooked up 50 or more clients. Each, we did the math to hook people up, considering the distance of the client from the base station and the curvature of the earth, we could not get a connection. After many tests, we quit using the curvature value. Guess what? We connected every time. I didn't give it as much thought. I thought we did not do the math correctly. I was just so happy we found the trick to making those connections. The trick was that there is no 8-inch per mile drop. Now it's 2017, and I am not in that business anymore. You said in your video that you would like to find other technical people to speak to. Microwave shots that carry internet signals and communication signals can travel up to 50 miles. These are line-of-sight connections. I am sure you could find people in these industries that will tell you that there is no compensation for the curve of the earth. And this is a guy, it's out of Marshall, Missouri. Awesome. Thanks, man. It's great. And just like that, subject matter expert. Although he's not an official one, but still, it's great. Yeah, why not? This one's called Quick Question. Hi, Mark. Is there any video footage of bringing the sun back into view using a strong zoom after it sets or zooming in on it before it actually rises? Thanks a lot for your work. Samuel E. Gaziz. Gaziz? G-A-Z-I-S. Gaziz. Yeah, look, phone call came in. And yeah, there are. Just type in Flat Earth Sunset or Flat Earth Sun and you'll see it. 510 area code. Turn on your radio in the background. Where are you calling from? What are we talking about? What are we talking about?
Hey, Mark. How's it going, man? This is LaPena Carroll once again out of Pittsburgh, California.
Hey. Oh, yeah. Pittsburgh, California. That's such a weird name because everybody thinks. In fact, why'd they name it Pittsburgh? Why?
Man, I don't know. I'm about to find that one out. That's a good question.
I mean, anyway.
Go ahead. Yeah. But, you know, a lot of cities be chiming off one another.
Yeah.
Just like I was surprised to hear that it was a country called Georgia.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? I also heard there's a New Mexico.
Oh, well, there you go.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, Flat Earth Man, anything is possible. Yeah, but I just want to call in and put my tidbit in to say congratulations on the 100th episode.
Thank you.
Obviously, been a fairly, I think I've been listening for at least about maybe 6 months now.
Cool.
And been listening live for, I want to say, like the last month due to my friend in New York, Mark in New York.
Nice.
Yeah, so, man, I just want to let you know, keep up the good work. And I'm really, really proud of the work that Mark is putting in over in New York, man. I haven't been able to get part of a lot of forums that he's been trying to get me a part of due to the fact that, like he has said, taking care of my wife. And unfortunately, we lost my brother-in-law last week. But nevertheless, we're pushing forward.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
I appreciate that. I really do. But, yeah, once again, just keep up the great work. I look forward to calling in yet once again. Never really got to tell you how I even got started in this whole this deep rabbit hole, but try to catch up with you on the next episode if possible.
Cool. And, yeah, I will be around.
Most definitely. Definitely looking try to make the time out there to come out to ride. I mean, yeah, it's so true, man. I mean, this is going to be an awesome event, and I definitely don't want to miss it, you know. And hey, man, sit there and say that, hey, man, I was there. And another shout out, I want to give a shout out to my kids when I had played the episode from last week. No, not last week, the week before last.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was about, I don't know, about almost 1 o'clock my time because my wife was, you know, at the hospital at the time. And as soon as they heard their dad come up, they all got pranked. I'm like, I knew that was bad. Shout out to my kids, man.
Nice.
Yeah, once again, keep up the great work. And I appreciate all the effort.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And, keep fighting the good fight, man.
Most definitely. Take care. Have a good one. And I'm going on back in.
All right.
All right, Mark, my friend in New York, keep it up, my brother. Keep it pounding. And, yeah, also became friends with Lee, one of your experts you had. We haven't got to talk too much since I spoke to him, but, yeah, everybody keep up the great work in the community. Let's keep it going.
All right, man. Hey, you have a good night.
All right. Take care. You too as well.
All right. Bye-bye. All right. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. Will you call in for the 100th episode of Strange World? Really, what excuse do you have at this point? If you've been listening to them all throughout the last couple of years, then why not? You don't have to be nervous. You know I don't attack anybody. Man, just like that. 218 area code is coming in. Let's see what they got to say. 218 area code. You are on.
Am I actually on the radio with you?
You are on with me right now.
I've been listening to you probably a couple of years.
Right on. Where are you calling?
I'm in Minnesota.
That's all right.
Rural Minnesota.
Cool.
And I know people wonder why you don't really want to give your name and number all the time and things, and if you're working within the community, you might not be able to get, like, babysitting jobs or housekeeping jobs.
I know. I
think you're a little bit off.
I've heard horror stories of people. It's like, oh, yeah, I'm in a flat earth. It's like, it doesn't go over necessarily really well with some people.
And probably a lot of politicians probably want to put their
the more the more influence you have, the more popular you are. That's why when B.O.B. came out or those athletes came out, it's like, good for them putting yourself out there. You know, Shaquille O'Neal, he held on for 5 days, but when you make $20 million a year, you got to be careful.
No, I loved it when they came out because I was telling some kids, and of course, it just blew their minds, but I've got an 86-year-old friend, and I approach it a little bit cautiously with him because I don't want him to just fall flat, you know?
and really, you should approach it cautiously with everybody. Don't assume, you say, oh, yeah, my friend, he's totally open-minded. He will completely understand what I'm laying down. Don't ever assume that. Because there's the conditioning. You don't know. I mean, unless they're homeschooled, maybe, if they're homeschooled, it's not a guarantee. But if they have just straight up public school conditioning, if they've got a master's degree in anything, a physical science, nope, don't do it. Don't do it.
I think the rebels who never did trust authority much, even in grade school.
Good point.
They have an easier time with that.
Yeah, good point.
For me, the litmus test was, I keep saying this at different places, but if you're alone in the middle of the night about 2 a.m. Mm-hmm. and you really try to embrace the concept of a spinning globe flying through a vast universe with rocks whizzing by, it's scarier than hell.
Oh yeah! It should scare the hell out of everybody if that was the real model.
It's a really bad bedtime story, you know.
Oh yeah.
And if you think about it being a flat Earth, it's like it's just a sense of peace, and you're like, it's okay then, you know, and you're good with it.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about meteors and solar radiations or the sun blowing up or all any of this stuff. You don't have to worry about any of that.
Somebody created it. You're here for a purpose, and it's under control. And you're like, gotcha, you know.
I think it makes things a whole lot easier. I mean, some people get a little claustrophobic at first. I get that. But it's like, really, did you need all that space? Seriously, a 10,000-foot mansion. You walk around in that. You get lost. You get lonely in one of those.
Would you want to clean it?
Nice one. They did a scientific study. The average person, the average human being, only needs about 1,500 square feet of space. Now that's per person. So if you're like a single person in a 1,500 foot house, that's more than your psychological makeup needs. So a flat Earth totally should be fine for people. An enclosed system totally should be fine. Anyway,
I'm gonna throw one more thing at you if you don't mind.
Sure.
I'm trying to try to help out the flat earth where I can, but I started a website, fecards.com.
Fecards?
And it's simply to have like little business cards or stickers or whatever.
Nice.
Where, you know, for 15 cents when you go out and have a cup of coffee, you could leave just a little card there.
That's a great idea.
That somebody can pick up, and you know, in the back room, and they don't want anybody watching them. They can like, what's this?
I like where you're going with that. Fecards.com. That's awesome.
Right. And I'm more open to suggestions from anybody, friendly ones, as far as how to create things.
Sure.
I try to cut costs down as much as possible.
Sure.
Unfortunately, I'm kind of...
That's all right. That's cool. So
well, if I actually managed to scrape the nickels together, I'd be more than happy to join the conference.
Hey, you know, there's plenty of time between now and then. You never know. Don't.
I think people might need to start organizing a few minibuses or something.
There you go. Where are you right now? What state?
I'm in Minnesota.
Minnesota. It's not too bad. But yeah, I think we can. We'll see who's going where. You know,
somebody needs to maybe start over how many buses, you know, and we can contact this one over here coming down from the north, you know.
Yeah, I hear you. Turn it into sort of like a million flat march.
I thought it'd be great if we marched in the 4th of July parade.
Oh, boy. All right.
I appreciate taking the call, Mark.
Oh, no. Hey, love having you join in. Fantastic. And you have a good night, okay?
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That phone number is 720-897-6111. And hey, you know what? It's the 100th show. 100 shows. And just like that, 714 is calling in. See what they want. 714, you got 3 minutes until the break. So where are you calling from? What are we talking about? Don't be nervous and make it good.
Hey, Mark. Yeah, I've been a flat earther now for like since July when I started. Well, when I first started researching this, I was researching the axis tilt because I noticed the sun was coming up wrong from where I live. I've been in the same house since... 93.
Okay.
Anyway, once you get into the flat earth stuff, you get, you know, blown away and you're into it. But I just wanted to bring this to attention to you guys and Skiba and Zane Garcia. I've been seeing his model and how the sun works. And it goes from the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, how it stays between those bands. And
yeah.
Well, I live in California. The sun should never be setting north of me or rising north of me, and it is now, and it's been doing this for I guess 10 years because there's another YouTube video out there where a guy talks about it. It's called the obliquity increase.
Right. I know what you're talking about. I've watched part of that video, and yeah, it's interesting. I haven't delved too much into it, but it is interesting.
Yeah, and so I've seen Antonio, I watch a lot of these flat earth videos. I'm real, real into it right now.
Yeah.
And those guys are trying to make a map tracking the sun. So I don't know if they know that the sun's not going right anymore or like, you know, when I first saw the sun, that's because, you know, the world tilted, but that's not going to work on the flat earth model. And I'm 100% sure it's, you know, we're flat. That's what I believe in.
Nice.
But. Well, you know, I'm just nervous, that's all.
Dude, you don't have to be nervous. It's just you and me and whoever else is listening.
So, cool.
It's totally cool. Besides, you know full well, if you've listened to the show at all, I don't yell at people.
Yeah, I know. I listen a lot and you're finally on the air. It's the first time I decided to call. It's like, you know, hey,
you picked a good time. It's the 100th episode.
Cool.
And you got in. That's awesome. And after, you know, in the following weeks to come, provided I'm not drone striked, call in again. And it gets easier with time. Trust me. My first episode, I think I had 3 glasses of wine, and it's like, okay, I can do this. You just You just get comfortable with yourself after a while.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, just like you're talking to someone, you know, like you're not that you're not normal, but like just get like, you know, like a celebrity status. So that's
don't do that to me. Oop,
and you're doing a great job, you know, bringing this to light and
well, thanks.
You know, putting this out there. So, I mean, I hope the 100 monkey effect, 100 monkey effect takes effect. And
I hope so too.
People, you know, start clicking and say, hey, the world's not what they told you what it was. It's a big lie.
I think we're getting there. I mean, if the first part of this year is any indication, I think we're going. Oh, music's kicking in. All right, man. Thanks for calling.
Cool. Thanks, Mark.
Talk to you soon. Bye bye.
All right. His face is in the muck. I think his zipper's stuck.
No hate. No hype. No fear. We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 404, your last chance to call in during the 100th episode. And I think somebody called while we were on break, but I couldn't hear who it was. Who is it? 601 area code.
Mark, this is Brandon from Mississippi. How are you today?
I'm doing well. How about you?
Congratulations on your 100th show. I'm doing well.
Thank you.
I actually was the caller that called in 30 seconds of your last episode. I didn't really have much of a chance to talk to you.
Oh, okay.
I've been a big fan of you, man. You're great. I've been listening to you for, I think, about a year and a half. I can't remember exactly when I started. I think it was last summer.
Mm-hmm.
Your clues, of course, blew my mind, like many of your listeners. And a couple of questions that I wanted to ask you.
Sure.
First, what do you think the definitive event will be that will bring what you've been calling critical mass?
It's the silver bullet, in other words. The silver bullet is, for me, I don't know if there's going to be any one single event. I think, honestly, it's going to be some sort of mainstream event that they're going to deliberately make a mistake along those, you know, whether or not they push it off on. Right now, if I had to take money bets, I'd put it on SpaceX, saying that SpaceX is going to do something, they're going to try to attempt something, and it's going to go so badly that people aren't going to buy it. The general, even the lowest common denominator is not going to buy it. They're going to look, it's like, that looks like the most fake thing ever. And that's what I'd look at first. I mean, yeah, of course, yeah. All the old experiments are still good and they still work, but I'm still kind of looking for, you know, I don't think there's any one scientific experiment that's going to convince the masses. I think it's going to have to be dictated by the mainstream media, because I still think, and you've probably heard me say it on different things, that Flat Earth is just part of a bigger picture, that we're just the frame for something that's going to be painted inside of it. And
I do agree with you on that.
It just seems like it's like, look, Flat Earth, because it opens your mind to the concept of other things, and exactly what that other thing is going to be, take your pick, but it's got to be huge, whatever it is.
Exactly.
So
my second question would be something I've had trouble with since the beginning, and I think I've briefly heard you touched on it before. Certainly watched Eric DeBay's video, and I didn't really grasp what he was saying. I'm not sure he did either. On the stars, the constellations, you already know I'm going with this, in the Southern Hemisphere, the star trails. Can you briefly explain those? I'm going to hang up and listen, but once again, congratulations on 100 episodes. It's epic.
Oh, thanks.
Keep up the good work. Keep the faith, brother.
Thank you. When it comes to the constellations. Yeah, okay. When it comes to the constellations in the Southern Hemisphere, and I won't pick up a call while I'm trying to answer this. For me, I differ from other people only that, look, if a planetarium, because remember, the website I built is called enclosedworld.com. I believe we live in a planetarium, a terrarium, a Hollywood backlot soundstage. Of course, it's not Hollywood. It's something else. You know, space Hollywood, whatever you want to call it. The projection systems we use for planetariums are single in nature because you're not covering that much ground. But if you're talking about a building, a structure that is thousands of miles wide, tens of thousands of miles wide, and maybe 1,000, 2,000 miles high, you're going to be using multiple projection systems. So that when you're looking at the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere, on a flat Earth, it's the inner circle and the outer circle, you can look at different things. Both people, like you have one friend in North America, one person in Australia. They both say, yeah, I'm looking at, we're not going to go into the super details here. We both are looking at the Belt of Orion. We're on the phone talking to each other, right? Although both people think they are looking at the same Belt of Orion, they're actually looking at two completely different systems. We are doing this. We've been doing this in software for the last 15, 20 years. It's called instancing or phasing, and that is the realization of an object, which is you. And you can do this by geographic location. You can do this by individual if you had to. And I don't really want to cross the line here and jump into the matrix or a simulated reality or anything like that. I'm saying we can do this physically right now. And we can do this. We can do this in our own building. We could build a Truman Show and would need to do this for multiple projection systems. They didn't go into the details of exactly how they simulated the sky in the Truman Show, which was probably good because then people would be dissecting that thing a lot. Anyway, hopefully I answered that as best I could. Got to get in a few more calls before we wrap up the 100th show. 720-897-6111. And I know people have been calling, so please hit the redial button, 720-897-6111. And while we're waiting for those calls, check out that one caller at Flat Earth or fecards.com. Oh, 303 area code. That's got to be Colorado. You are on live with Strange World right now, and you're calling from Colorado. Am I right?
Yes, you are.
Cool. Who am I talking to?
Tony from Denver.
Tony from Denver. How's it going, Tony?
Hey, thanks, Mark, for 100 shows. I don't call every week, but I always listen.
Well, I'm glad you listen, and I'm glad that you're finally calling.
I really appreciate all the hard work that you've been doing.
Thank you.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
NASA announces news about ocean planets.
Whatever.
Miniaturized the satellites to test Europa moon dust and radiation.
Yeah.
And they said Mars has metal in its atmosphere.
Uh-huh.
And then they're going to do a 4K live stream later this month.
From where?
If space is fake, how does NASA have endless news about something that doesn't exist?
Well, it's a good point. And that is you have to have endless news about this, because you have to remember, and if you've listened to my stuff, you've heard me say this before, it's not about the story out there, it's about the story down here. So, and they just do a shotgun pattern approach. So, because they know that somebody's going to find something interesting about it if they just throw out enough stories. Let's talk about reclassifying Pluto back as a planet again. Let's talk about the hexagram that's on top of Saturn. Let's talk about the face that's on Mars, and so on and so on and so on. It does not matter what you believe when it comes to these things. It doesn't matter if you even believe in the face on Mars, but if you think about it for more than 10 seconds, It's the subtext. That is, you're thinking about it from a globe. Saturn from a globe. Mars from a globe. Pluto from a globe. Always the globe. That's the drumbeat. They can make up as many stories as they want, because the underlying beat is the globe. That's all they care about. Because as long as you believe in the globe, then everything in space is at least possible. Even though you might not care, or you know, your interest, you know, it peaks in certain areas. But yeah, talking about a planet, you know, other super Earths or planets that have water, or planets in the Goldilocks zone, Mars, you know, we haven't done anything on Mars ever. And yet they say that there's been like 48 attempted missions to Mars. Most people don't even know that. It's a good con. And I do like that. Even the UFOs is a good con. We'll see the stuff that they're talking about for next year. That's the interesting stuff. and that is, you know, or the stuff that's even supposed to happen in the next 6 months, which is the, was it the Google, not the Google X challenge. Is it the Google X challenge? I think it is, where some probe, five companies from different countries are supposed to send a probe to the moon. And they, you know, and first one to beam back a picture from the moon gets $20 million. It's like, what, why now? Now you're doing this? Why now? It's because of us. And no different with the SpaceX thing. All the SpaceX is paying themselves into a corner, and I don't know where they're going to go. It's horrible. Because the 4K camera thing you were talking about, this is just like SpaceX cannot go to the moon without a whole bunch of 4K cameras running. They're going to go against the rules that NASA has set down, which is don't show any movies or pictures ever. Because if somebody finds out that we're faking it, we're all sunk. And that's how I think it's going to go down. I think SpaceX is going to attempt it. They're going to let it happen. They're going to try to fake it. And it's going to fall. They're going to fall flat on their face. And then people are going to say, wait a minute. Why? If they're faking it and it's fraud, then what? Just goes snowballs from there. Anyway, sorry. I was rambling. What else you got?
Well, no more questions, but I did want to come to the defense of Rob Skiba. There was this guy, Infinite Plane, that represented you in Albuquerque just recently.
Right.
And yeah. In one of his newest videos, he really went after Rob Skiba and you to a little, you know, like on climate change.
Yeah.
And I asked you before about climate change myself, and I understood your answer. You were talking about HAARP and, you know, manipulation of the weather.
Yeah.
All of that made sense, and I didn't see why he had to attack you, but he really went after Skiba. And I'm religious. My kids go to Catholic school, and I don't see the big deal with being a religious person and believing in the flat earth. I mean, everybody has their own personal views.
Yeah, again, religion.
I don't see, maybe he's trying to make a name for himself.
Well, it's not even that. You got to remember that, yeah, 8 out of 10 people in the world are tied to one of the big five religions. But that also means that 2 people out of every 10 aren't. And those people are, you know, they get into defensive stance. You know, they don't like, I hate to use this because people are going, oh, but they don't like being preached to, literally don't like being preached to. And he's one of those, you know, he's an intelligent, articulate guy, and he's not going to back down. So, going against Rob is not probably your best move, because Rob is one of the nicest guys you ever want to meet, and a straight shooter to boot. And he's not, I mean, yeah, he's got a pretty big following, but he's not shy about where he comes from. He's Bible first, Christianity first, and flat earth second. So, we'll see. You know, everyone. Go ahead.
One other thing I wanted to bring up about the Infinite Plane. You were on a show with Nathan, I think it is, from England.
Yeah, and Infinite came on. Yeah.
You were presenting pictures of Mason pillars, maybe I got that right?
The five Masonic tracing boards. Nathan called, boards. Yeah, the tracing boards. He asked me if the Masons know more about flat earth than they're leading on. And I said at the very, very, very tippy top, yeah, maybe. But the ground troops definitely don't. I mean, remember, soldiers don't know. Only even colonels and lieutenants and majors and captains don't know what the generals, and even then, only a few of the generals really know the whole game plan. So, I'm sorry. I didn't let you finish that.
Well, the tracing boards, that's what I wanted to ask you about. I guess I do have another question.
Yeah.
I know you do a lot of videos and you like to stay focused on the flat earth, but that seemed amazingly interesting to me. And I'd never heard anything about that before. And might be fertile ground for maybe a sub video. I don't know if you want to put it on.
That's a good one. In fact,
I couldn't see those pictures very good on Nathan's show there. And
that's okay. Here's what I'll do, because I'll probably do a clue on this anyway, tied to the Masonic tracing boards. But if you want to look it up, because you can find this is not, you know, I laminated those boards just so I could show people when I was out and about. But you know, if I didn't have a computer lying around, but. If you want to look it up, all you have to do is go into any search engine, type in Masonic tracing boards, and hit the images button, and you will see it. There's only 5 of them out there, and eventually, if you go to the website, you'll find, you know, some that'll list them by name, you know, what order they're in. But the 5 boards, if you start staring at them long enough, you'll start thinking of it in terms of an enclosed world, flat earth type of system. You'll start seeing it, And I saw it right away. Of course, I'd been staring at those boards for a few years before I got into Flat Earth. So it was easier for me, but it was fascinating.
I'm definitely going to do it. I thought that was the neatest part of that show. I've never heard of that before.
Yeah.
So I guess I need to thank you again, besides the 100th show, for introducing me to the tracing boards. Tracing boards.
Nice. Cool. Any shout outs? I want to try to get a few more calls before I shut down.
Nope, that's it. Thanks, right. Mark, and thanks for the 100th show.
All right. Talk to you soon. All right. Whoever was 920, please try to call back in. I know there was a whole bunch of calls that were trying to get in there. Wow, there's a lot of calls. And no, Peanut Gallery, I was not going to last 15 minutes of the show left. Yeah, I know. I will do my thing here. We'll do 281. This will be the last call. 281. 281, you're going to be the last call for the evening. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Houston, Texas. Can you hear me very well?
I can. And you're the last call of the 100th show on Strange World.
Well, it's Patricia Steer. How are you?
Holy smokes, your voice sounds so different when it's on the phone.
No, it's just because let me switch here. Is this better right now?
Yeah, it's a little better.
Okay, good. I'm calling, was calling through my car system, and I've heard my iPhone doesn't do very well with phone calls. But anyway, forget about how bad I sound. You sound great, and I just wanted to call and congratulate you on 100 episodes, and I've listened to every single one of them, not always live, but every single one of them.
Oh, well, that's awfully nice. And how appropriate. Honestly, I did not recognize your phone number because I get dizzy because there's quite a few phone numbers coming in from that area anyway. So
yeah. That's
awesome. And thank you. It's again, time flies. Who would have thought?
All right. Well, I'll let the line go for other people that want to talk to you because I'm just going to talk to you tomorrow on the Secret Show.
That's true. We are going to talk tomorrow on the Secret Show. Let's do the plug right now. Tomorrow I'm going to be on this woman's show, Patricia Steer, and it's going to be – it is 1:55 tomorrow, right?
It's 1:54 actually. Yes.
You told me 1:55. That's what I made.
No, that was for the next week.
Oh, okay. So you're using something different for our thing. So the
yes,
the thumbnail exactly. I gave you, you're going to use. All right.
Yeah. So it's tomorrow on Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes on YouTube at 3 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Mountain, 5 p.m. Central, 6 p.m. Eastern, and 11 GMT.
Cool. Be there or be an unwashed heathen globalist.
Exactly. Be there or be sphere.
Nice.
Okay.
All right.
Bye.
See ya. Bye-bye. Okay. And the peanut gallery is now bugging me and saying, no, there's not enough time. You're going to have to do your heartfelt thing. Which I'm going to do. You know what? I'm not going to take any more calls. Well, maybe I'll take. I've got like 9 minutes, man. That's a long time. And he says 3 p.m. ish, give or take. Yeah, good point. Peanut Gallery. Will Patricia be on time for tomorrow's show? 206 area code. You know what? I'm going to take one more because I don't need that much time to do my thing at the end here. Here we go. 206. 206 area code. You are going to be the last call tonight.
Awesome. I beat Patricia. This is Elizabeth. How are you?
Go figure. It's Elizabeth.
She did sound really different.
She did, didn't she? Her voice was like higher pitched. Well, she uses that high-end mic. So her voice sounds really low and throaty. Yeah. Sounds like Kathleen Turner when she's on her normal mic, but there she did not sound like Kathleen Turner.
She was a regular person.
She was. She was just like normal people.
So happy 100th episode.
Oh, thank you.
And I started listening right when Candy said, this is Mark Sargent. And then they said they were on that hangout. So I was on my computer. So I had that hangout watching and listening while all that was going on. It was kind of crazy.
Isn't their hangout like still going on? Or they finally shut it down?
I think so. I had to hang it up. And I was working and I kept hearing these voices. And I'm like, oh, they're coming out of those headphones. But I had different headphones to hear your show.
Nice.
Two things. I'll just comment quick.
Sure.
The moon is perfectly round. That does not make any sense. Some people like to use that as their reasoning. Well, planets are round, so they're
round. Well, I got to correct you there. Remember, use the word sphere, ball, or globe. Remember, dinner plate is round.
It's a 360-degree perfect circle, the
okay.
moon.
Yeah.
I don't know what's behind it, but the part we could see, like, that's not even...
Oh, it's a perfect
you
circle.
You look at an apple and an orange, and things are not perfectly 360 degrees like that.
Good point.
It's just weird.
Why is it not lumpy?
It's just weird.
Yeah.
I was thinking maybe it's like if there is water, maybe that's the plug, but it's not a quark.
Hey, I've never heard that
just
before.
Just trying
that's
to
good.
Figure things out, but it was really, really full yesterday, and I was just staring at it going, this is so weird.
Yeah, good point.
The other thing, and people have commented this before too, but it is crazy. Every single movie on Earth has a globe in it.
Yeah, I know.
As soon
I know.
As you
not,
just see
not
a
just
kid's
every...
bedroom, you go, oh, where's the globe? And then, you know, the next scene, there it is. Or you see an office in the house. Every time there's a globe.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I've got shows that are – I'm not necessarily binge-watching them. They're in the background. Everybody's freaking office, especially up high, has globes and sometimes two of them. There's
and
like,
that's not like real life.
No,
people
no.
don't have that many globes.
No, I mean, it's a detective's office. What the heck is a globe doing on top of that filing cabinet? In fact, I was late to show Bones, which is going to finally wrap up its final season. And I don't necessarily follow it, but it's a good background show to have. There's a globe in everybody's freaking office. It's like, what? They're CGI. They do genetic material analysis. Why do they care about the globe? You're absolutely right. I've seen that more and more and more. And that goes along.
It has to be the government influence on what.
It's that Russian vids thing, if you remember, where he was talking to a director who said that these weird, you know, producers will walk onto set and they'll say, how much does it cost to shoot this scene? Fine, we'd like to do set design for this scene. And they come into the room and it doesn't look any different. It's like, what did you guys do? And like in this case, you know, they put a weird map on the wall. But I think sometimes it's like, oh, they just add a globe. How cheap and easy is that? Okay, we'll pay a couple $1,000s. No director's ever going to question this because all they care about is making the money. So we're going to put the globe in the corner. Yeah.
And the other quick thing that is so fake, and so I just recently saw a movie that had space in it. And on movies, there's always the stars. You can see all the other stars or you can see space junk.
Yeah.
Why is it on the NASA stuff there you can't see any other star and there's no space junk?
Agreed.
Except the ISS.
Agreed. The entire concept of the movie Gravity with Sandra Bullock and, dare I say it, yes, George Clooney, was about satellites spinning out of control, shredding each other, and then the entire orbital system around the world turned into this gauntlet of metal, and it caused a catastrophic failure at a space station, and that was the premise of the movie. And nobody even thought, you know, it's like, oh, a great 3D movie, but nobody even thought by the time you got to the end of it, it's like, wait a minute, why hasn't that happened already?
Right. That's what those guys on ISS should talk about instead of showing us how they shampoo their hair
exactly.
or make apples float.
They should be talking about how scared they are that if a meteor the size of a nickel punches through them, they're all doomed. Yeah, I get it. Anyway, I've got to
okay.
I got to run.
Okay, happy 100th episode.
Thank you.
We'll
you are
you
absolutely
week.
My last call for the evening.
Awesome.
All right. Hey, have a good one.
Okay, bye.
Bye. All right. Guys. I'm not going to get all choked up, but yes, 100 episodes. I would like to thank all the people, and I'm not going to be able to do it justice here, that have helped me get this far, because when I started doing the Flat Earth Clues back in February of 2015, so it's been over 2 years now since the clues came out, never did I think in a million years that the community would be as robust, as enthusiastic and creative and eccentric and eclectic and so inspirational and motivational to each other. I mean, yeah, of course there's infighting, but even the infighting has a purpose, I believe. And that is we challenge each other because we can't get mainstream science to challenge us because we just steamroll them. And it's been fantastic. Everybody, you know, I'm not going to list off everybody that I should thank because there's too many. There's too many people in the community. If you type in Flat Earth into the search engine, into YouTube now, the number has skyrocketed. Before the beginning of 2015, you typed in Flat Earth into YouTube, you got maybe 50,000 results. You type it in today, you sort by upload date, you get, and we're gaining on 17 million. And you're thinking, wow, is that a lot? Well, yeah, it's a lot. Talk about return on investment. That's monstrous. You type in Donald Trump, the most talked about president of all time, and he's only been in a few months. He comes up at about 18 million, and we're pushing 17 million. That gives you an idea of how freaking huge we are. And he was at, and granted, he took a massive jump. He wasn't even at 7 or 8 million before he got elected. And now he's huge because everybody wants to talk to him. That's what you do. You bash on the president. But the point is that the community has grown in leaps and bounds. We've got hangouts every single day. And they're not lightweight hangouts. These are knockdown, drag out marathons. Some going 6-9 hours or max, whatever the max cap is on YouTube hangouts. The community events that are happening, the fact that Colorado is now doing weekly events, which I'm going to make a trailer for. Florida is doing it. I've done mixers, multiple mixers now in Seattle and Victoria, which has been fantastic. And then, of course, the convention, which is coming up in the fall, November, second week, November 9th and 10th, down in Raleigh, North Carolina. Everyone that's there is super cool. No, and I know people say, well, couldn't you invite this person or this person? It's like, look, I wasn't involved in the picking of the people, but it's going to be fantastic regardless. Look, not everybody could be invited to be a keynote speaker or be on a panel. There just isn't enough room for them. There's just so many good people in the community, which is fantastic. So I'd like to thank everybody I've worked with so far, everybody has interviewed me, everybody I have interviewed. And subject matter experts, I'd love to do another project with you. So if I have interviewed you in the past and you're a subject matter expert, please email me. And I want to get a hold of you again for something down the road. I'm not going to tell you what it is yet. Anyway, like I try to end other things. 10 commandments, I don't know them by heart. I don't. I know a little chapter and verse, but I don't know the 10 commandments. What I try to tell people, one rule I live my life by, and that is treat others better than you treat yourself. If you do that, the world will be a better place. Hey, will this stop all the infighting? Not necessarily, but that's okay. We're going to get there together, all of us, from point A to point B. Flat Earth will hit critical mass, and the world will change in a way you never thought it could. Also, special thanks real quick to Peanut Gallery, who's been helping me the whole year. It's been fantastic. Tomorrow, going to be on Patricia Steer's show, 3 p.m. Hey, guys. See you next week. Same flat time, same flat channel.
Evie, what is this? What is this? Is that a model of the flat, geocentric Earth?
Nice. I had to make a new one. What are you doing?